ventricular tachycardia, but there can be some younger patients as well who can come with VT. If a younger patient comes with VT, what kind of VTs are they? Most of the times, of course, non-ischemic VTs are like fascicular VTs. So we all have to be really careful for that. So then how about the symptoms? So if someone is presenting with these complaints, you should try to think that yes, chances are very high. Then always try to do some electrolytes as well. And try to take the history of cardiac disease, myocardial infarction, congestive heart disease, whether the patient has some renal disease as well. If there's a family history of sudden cardiac death, or if there's a history of family is having arrhythmias as well. And what kind of drugs as well someone is taking. That's very important. Because if someone is taking a QT prolongation drug, so the chances of VT will increase, of course, isn't it? So what if similarly, if someone is a drug addict as well. So then, let's not try to forget our basics is physical examination. So in the physical examination, you should try to see if the patient is stable or not. Is there any associated stroke? Is there any usage of pacemaker or ICDs? I think because we saw those previous ECGs, how are they going to help? Is there any evidence of AV dissociation? So AV dissociation, not only you look on ECGs, but also you try to look clinically as well. And then you can also do some clinical maneuvers. So for example, the cardiac sinus massage, pharmacological interventions with the usage of all these drugs. So regarding the other tests as well, you can do some laboratory tests, chest x-ray, and the echocardiography. And of course, with the ECG, you can always give a much more conclusive picture. Is it really a sinus rhythm? Or is it something like a white complex tachycardia? So as we can see beautifully in this ECG, what is this? P is here somewhere, then comes here, then goes in the back, then falls on there, then over here. So this is what is classical of the AV dissociation. So this is a very nice algorithm, a summary, to if you're trying to aim, differentiate whether it is a white crest tachycardia, is it a VT, ventricular tachycardia, or not. So I think most of these signs we already spoke about it earlier, isn't it? So these signs as well, we have already spoken about it, actually. So now, we are going towards the end. What about its therapy? If whenever you come across an unstable patient, never hesitate to give a shot. If you come across a white complex tachycardia, if you are in doubt, treat it like a ventricular tachycardia. No thoughts about it. But of course, if you are good, you can differentiate, you should. And yes, if the patient is, as you can see, if the patient is stable, that is the time you will be starting to use all those algorithms which you all come across. So for example, if it is a stable patient, yes, you can use a class 1 or class 3 antiarrhythmic drugs. We'll try to find out the etiology. What is the predisposing etiology for that? We'll try to treat that. And still, if the patient needs cardioversion, you can plan an electric cardioversion. And the patient has pacemaker, then try to intervene for that. And in the therapy for trying to see for the tonic management, these are some of those proven therapies. Antiarrhythmic drugs, of course. There's a big role for the EPS plus RFA as well. And it is one of the standalone therapies for the idiopathic VTs, in fact. And yes, if there is a ischemic VT in which you cannot give foolproof success rate with ablation, it has to be used as the adjunctive therapy. So for example, if the patient is already on pacemaker, someone is getting repetitive shocks, you want to decrease that, you should try to use some ablation procedures as well for that. So these are some of the slides showing the indication for the EPS. So what are these class 1 indications? So if a patient has come with white complex tachycardia, and then you have seen the ECG, and okay, and then the diagnosis is unclear. Is it VT? Is there something else? If you really want to be sure, that is definitely one of the types. You can try to use it as well. And of course, as I said, it has a big role in therapy as well. So in the EP study, what you try to do? You try to reduce the arrhythmia,
we try to do activation mapping, pace mapping. Of course, there are a lot of scar mapping as well, which you can try to do, in fact. And there are newer concepts, what is called as LAVA. So low abnormal voltage ablation, in fact, as well. So what is this? What is this color thing? Colorful thing. So this is what is activation map. Now, science has progressed quite a lot, and you can even visualize those ECGs actually. You can even see those propagation, how the tachycardia is propagating. That's what you try to see. This is for RVOTVT. You try to go to the do a pace map. If it matches well, so you know you are in the right spot. So similarly, this is something interesting, guys, because a lot of times we get confused. Shall we put up our ICD or not? If ejection fraction is less than equal to 35%, RCD is indicated. But if the EF is more than 40%, definitely not. But if it is in between, you should do an EP study. Because there is conclusive data from the MUST trial, that's what you should try to do. To summarize, first of all, we need to be sure of the diagnosis. If we are really sure, then we should do good management to the patient. And if the patient is, of course, unstable, immediately cardioverted, and the long-term management, there is a big role for the antiarrhythmic drugs, ablation, and of course, ICDs as well. Thank you so much. If there are any questions, I'll be happy to answer. So after this long lecture, I think it is time to get a little bit more stimulated. Some brain stimulating questions from the vast experience of Dr. Ajay Kumar Sinha we are going to get. And mind you all.
Just a comment.
Yes, sir.
See, learning ECG and cardiac arrhythmia and things like that, they have to be more fascinating. It is not that just seeing a few couple of pictures you learn. Every day we are seeing patients in the OPD or indoor, wherever, and keep on seeing that, keep on discussing that. Only thing I wanted to few comments about wide complex tachycardia, my experience. That wide complex tachycardia should be respected for VT and VT and nothing else. If you want to succeed and the patient is very sick, don't spend your time in journey of finding out what is the cause and genesis and pathogenesis. Don't. Just treat like, respect that wide complex tachycardia as VT. Go for talk or whatever you like. And this is the message I, you know, like we keep on telling and talking to many people in the territory, almost every district town. Like last time I spoke with IIM Devgar, I told everybody that everybody who is practicing medicine should have a defibrillator. Anyway, I said, how many of you are having a defibrillator? And nobody is a defibrillator because of fear that something will happen. I said, nothing will happen. Either the patient will survive or remain like that. The patient doesn't die because of defibrillator. That is what. Second thing, what Naren was telling us is absolutely correct. And we should, you know, like, unless we have more number of people with us to listen to us, there's no point, you know, spending so much of resources and energy. But shall I start my?
Yes, please. Yes.
So, this background, I think we have learned quite a bit of.
So, one last thing is, I think everyone is having the quiz sheet with them. Is everyone having it? Because we really want active participation from the audience.
And I'll request my cardiology colleague to come forward, Dina, Anand, and Sahin. But they are the people who will. Take participation in the discussion.
Feel free to participate in this. This is just open platform as well, and if others can answer the questions. As I said, there are four prizes to be won. Four prizes, okay?
So everyone.
And I love to, this is, you need to see that what is written in the bottom. No. Your ECG is slightly abnormal. But this is the biggest mistake which we physicians or general practitioners or a cardiologist do. Thodi si garbage aapke ECG mein hai. Never tell this. Never utter this language in front of people who are absolutely conscious about heart disease. And they think that heart disease is okay. And the second thing which I was telling that ECG has to be correlated with the clinical finding. There is nothing like ECG diagnosis. Unless you have a very strong clinical data with you, I mean, don't try to jump on the conclusion based ECG. These are the common things, not the cardiologist, but all of us should know. What is P wave? Where is the ventricular repolarization? Atrial repolarization? Where does it go? Where is the atrial repolarization? What's our BNP current? Where is the atrial repolarization? I'm not talking about depolarization.
Atrial repolarization is overlapping QRS complex.
Okay. So, we know all these intervals and what is what. What wave represents what we know that. And where is the PR interval? I'll just put a question.
Onset of P to onset of QRS.
Okay, but my first question for the quiz is, PR interval indicates conduction from? No, don't say. Don't utter. This is your single response and tick. Do not cut and revise. You can't revise. Okay. So, alright. So, we are giving you 30 seconds to answer this question. Hey Sahin, you are a trained cardiologist, you can't do that. So this is about A, B, C, D, any of that. You know, you put it